As a folklorist who has spent the last 30 years studying the cultural traditions of my home state, I'm dedicated to documenting and presenting the cultural roots of Alabama. Ride along as I encounter Alabama's folk practices where they occur and meet the people who continue them. I'm Joey Brackner, and this is Journey Proud. Today we're traveling through Lower Alabama to listen to the way people talk. I've invited linguist Dr. Anna Head Spence to ride with me and discuss the variety of ways that people communicate within our state. We'll learn about R-lessness, voiceless obstruents, and the Confederate vowel. We're going to Lower Alabama to begin the first of two episodes about language, dialect, and speech in Alabama. This is such an incredibly complex subject that we know we'll only be able to scratch the surface. I've invited linguist Dr. Anna Head Spence, who is currently on faculty at Enterprise State Community College, to ride with me and discuss the variety of ways that people communicate within our state. Anna is a former student of Drs. Robin Sabino and Thomas Nunley of Auburn University. She has done research in local phonology, the sounds of a dialect, and also in narrative or storytelling styles. We hope that in these episodes, we will pick up some differences in regional dialects in Alabama. We're also interested in how people view their own speech. To begin, we're heading to Anna's hometown of Elba, where she has collected flood narratives, and then we'll make our way through Lower Alabama to Mobile Bay. So we're headed to Elba, and that's your hometown.
It is.
And not only is it your hometown, but you have done linguistic field work there.
I have.
Would you tell me a little bit about that?
When I became interested in linguistics, my major professor and I originally talked about doing field work down at Dauphin Island, actually. But I always talked a lot about Elba and being from Elba with her. And so one day she said to me, why don't you just work in Elba, work in your home community? And one thing that was great about that right off the bat is that being familiar with the people, the likelihood of them being comfortable with me and there being natural speech promoted by that was higher. On the other hand, the hard part, I think, about working in your home community is when you're asking friends and neighbors to do something, I think you feel a little guilty. You feel, you know, these are your friends. You want to make sure that everything is done in a way that is a positive for them and not something that's burdening. And what I had been doing in these interviews up to this point is recording flood stories. And the reason I did that is because, first of all, it's something that everybody could talk about. But also, I did it because sometimes when people become engrossed in telling a story, including a natural disaster story, or maybe even especially a natural disaster story, they're more likely to use their natural speech.
Gotcha.
And in particular, at this point, I was looking at one vowel sound. And it's one of the most identifiable features of Southern speech. And that's that flat I versus the diphthong I.
I, yeah.
I. And of course, Southerners are known for using that flat I so much that it's been called the Confederate vowel.
So I have never heard that flat, that vowel sound referred to as the Confederate vowel. That makes sense though.
It's been called that, and if just to kind of demonstrate I versus I, there's with the diphthong, with the I sound, there's jaw movement. And with the flat I, there's not in the same way. So if you'll put your hand under your chin and say, I.
I.
And feel that chin go back up.
Mm-hmm.
And then go, I.
It
stays.
Yeah.
So that's one way you can sort of feel the difference in the two. And to be honest, when I first started investigating this particular feature of Southern speech, it was not hard for me to hear once I understood the difference, but it was hard for me to hear before I really did understand the difference, because for me it was mostly I. And that's a matter of intuition. I'm sure I use I, but as I recorded people in Elba over time, I just coded their narratives for when they used I and when they used I. And of course it's language variation. It's a variable. It means they use it sometimes and sometimes they don't.
Depending on the circumstances, perhaps, or the context, or who they're talking with, or...
Yes. In fact, one thing that constrains whether or not someone uses that flat I is the following sound. So, for example, if you were to have what's called a voiced obstruent, which is a voiced consonant, versus a voiceless consonant. And not all consonants are obstruents, but for example, T and D. Okay? So T is a voiceless obstruent. And obstruents, they are the consonants that are produced by a stoppage of airflow.
By
blocking the airflow.
So you can feel here.
Right, and you can feel whether it's voiced or voiceless. So the difference between a voiced and a voiceless sound is if the sound is voiced, you can feel vibration in your vocal cords.
Yeah.
So for example, if you make the D sound, duh,
duh. Yeah.
Versus the T,
tuh. Yeah, I see that.
You'll feel the vibration.
On the D, correct.
Right. People are more likely to use the I sound when they say words like ride and five than they are when they say words like right or light. Right and light are used among Southerners, but I would say they're more stigmatized.
Right.
So that's the variable that I looked at when I initially began collecting flit narratives.
Hey, when I just said right, what did I do?
What did you do?
I don't know. Right. Right. You know, this is part of the problem about talking about language, is that you become so self-conscious about your own speech.
Yes.
You're talking about it through the medium. It's crazy. By the time we arrive in Elba, Anna and I have decided the best way to start our interviews is with casual conversation to put our speakers at ease to allow for natural speech. We work our way over to City Hall, where we have arranged to meet the first of several of Anna's friends. City Councilwoman Rolanda Jones meets us and takes us into the council chamber. We really don't know how our unscripted interviews will work out, so we're just going to play it by ear.
This is where we all meet and make the decisions for Elba. This is my chair and where I sit, District 1, so I'm the first one here. And as you see, we have the city of Elba listed, and our mayor and clerk and members of the council are listed up, and past mayors here.
Rolanda, how long have you been on the council?
I've been on the council for now, this will be the fifth year.
Well, this is an unusual request, and we appreciate you meeting with us, because Anna and I want to go around and talk to folks in South Alabama about speech, the way they talk. And Anna suggested you. Y'all are friends. And we're here in Elba, and it's great to be here.
Yes, we're glad to have you here in Elba. Yes, I think I would say that I'm a Southern Belle. So I can kind of do, a little both. I have my professional talk, and then I just am me.
Mm-hmm.
And most of that is just, I'm Southern.
Right.
And I love being a Southern Belle, and I love the city of Elba. I just love living here.
Well, tell us a little bit about living in Elba and working on the city council.
I graduated in 1987 from Elba High School, which is no longer standing in the spot that it's standing in because we had a flood in 1990, then we had another flood, and that kind of wiped out our school system. And we do have the pillars over there that shows the front of the Elba High School where we all graduated as sentimental value. And then just living here in the city of Elba, I just decided that I wanted to have something to do besides just live here. I wanted to have something to do with making decisions here and just bettering our community and, you know, getting everything together according to what I thought it should look like from when I was a little girl, because things kind of changed after the flood and the look of Elba changed a little bit. And I wanted to be a part of making it look back like it used to. Like, you know, like I tell everybody, like Mayberry, so to speak.
The beautiful little town. And thank you for letting us interview you and telling us about the town. And we're gonna go look around.
Yes, sir. One of the places I would love for you all to visit is our Tigo Town Park area. And it's beautiful. It has those pillars of the Elba High School that was done away with after the flood.
So in this direction?
This way.
Okay, let's go look at it. Rolanda's speech is interesting in that when she described herself as a Southern Belle, she mimicked an exaggerated dialect, departing from her normal speech by emphasizing what linguists call R-lessness when she said the word Southern. It's interesting that she innately recognizes that being excessively R-less indeed makes her a Southern Belle. She also pointed out what we all know, that we change our speech or code switch depending on the social situation. In her case, when she moves between her two very important identities as a representative of Elba and a proud Southern African American woman. The city of Elba has done a remarkable job recovering from the series of floods that have affected the community. Tim Johnson has been a big part of this effort, and he has agreed to meet us for a chat in the city's new green space. Well, it's great to be in Elba, Tim, and I appreciate you letting us interview you in our show about speech, language, dialect in Alabama.
Well, good to have y'all here.
I guess it's pretty weird for somebody to come and want to talk to you about the way you talk.
A little strange.
So I'm going to let Anna do that.
Well, Tim, before we get to that, I was wondering first if you'd just tell us where we're sitting right now.
We're sitting on what we know as the Clements lot. About a year and a half ago, a group called the Community Development Corporation, or the CDC, purchased an old building that was here. The building was beyond repair. It had to be destroyed, and it left quite a gaping hole in our town square. Through private and public donations, this was redone, I guess, about 6 months ago now, or in that time frame, to be the park we have today.
It sounds like all your work keeps you right here in Elba these days, but Anna was telling me you used to have a job where you traveled around the state of Alabama and observing that not everyone speaks exactly the way the people in Elba do.
No, they do not. Every area I realized had its own dialect, and amazingly, people knew I was from the Wiregrass. So we have our own dialect too.
Yeah, we were talking to Rolanda, and she said, I'm from LA, Lower Alabama. And so there's that really, that sense of belonging to this region, correct?
Very much so.
Our next location where we're going to be heading is Mobile, and we have some native Mobilians living here in Elba, don't we?
We do. The superintendent of the city school system is actually from Mobile or Baldwin County. He's from one, his wife is from the other. And I think when you get to Mobile, you could find a few people from Elba who have been rather successful in Mobile as well.
We're headed to the causeway, which is halfway between Baldwin County and Mobile County, so it's perfect. Well, listen, Tim, we appreciate you taking the time to talk with us, and we're going to look around town, talk to somebody else before we head over to the bay. So
right.
It's great to meet you.
Very nice to meet you.
And y'all are doing a great job here in Elba.
Well,
it's looking beautiful. As Anna and I walk to meet our last interviewee, we reflect upon the way in which Tim embraced his local dialect when he invariably used the flat I in his speech as he described himself as a wiregrass speaker. Before we leave town, we plan to eat lunch at the Rabbit Hole restaurant. We've arranged to meet and speak briefly with attorney and local historian Matt Brunson at the mural on the outside of the restaurant.
And this must be Matt.
Yes.
Hey there.
Hey,
good
Matt.
Morning,
thanks so
Joey
much
Brankner.
For meeting us.
Hey,
Joey,
Matt Brunson.
Nice to meet you, Matt.
You as well.
This is a great mural.
It really is. It's an interesting project for the city. Each year, the city of Elba gets a student, and this was the brainchild of one of those students, and he was interested in doing a project that was not your typical landscape.
Your late dad is kind of a local historian of the founding of Elba and how it came to be here.
It was. Daddy was a lifelong resident of Coffee County, but for the time that he spent in school, he wrote about 7 books in all, and several of those dealt with local history. Actually, as part of Anna's doctoral work, she interviewed my father, and he spoke about the history of Elba and flood history. And to tell you, that's been a little while. She actually had given me a cassette tape of that recording, and I have had that dubbed into a CD, which I have now. I'd like to return it to you.
Thank you so much, Matt. I really appreciate that. Interviewing your dad and your mom and dad together was a great experience and something I was glad that I was able to capture and share later.
Well, it is quite the treasure for our family, I can tell you that. I wouldn't know the difference if it wasn't there, but I sure do treasure it. And we've given that out. All of his grandchildren have got a copy so that they'll know what he sounds like.
Well, I think we're going to head to the Rabbit Hole and have some lunch, but I appreciate your time.
Hey,
so
great.
Much.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you so much, Matt. I appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am.
Matt uses prominent features of Southern speech consistently as he discusses he and his dad's shared passion for local history. For example, Matt exhibits what both linguists and non-linguists are aware of, which is that Southerners use the N form of the variable ing more frequently. He uses this form not only with verbs, but also with adjectives and nouns such as interestin' and recordin'. Additionally, Matt uses the monophthongal flat I or Confederate vowel in all contexts. After a quick lunch, we take off for Mobile Bay, where we've arranged to meet one of Journey Proud's favorite folks, Jimbo Metter. Jimbo was one of Winston Groom's childhood friends who helped inspire his Forrest Gump character. We arrived when the sun was just going down and the light on the bay seemed to make everything glow. We spot Jimbo at his boat launch, where he takes people on eco tours into the Alabama Delta.
This is your business. It looks like a wonderful place to do business.
Well, it is. You know, people don't understand the whole delta that we have here. I mean, and so many people have lived right here all their lives and never been up there. So what I do is take tours up in the delta with small groups, you know, private tours, up to 6 people. And I take them in this boat right here so we can go back in places where most people can't go, you know, and see new spots. And there's all kind of bird life and flowers and stuff. Every day, every month, every week is different up here. So it's always something new and different to see. And what a lot of people don't realize is, you know, we talked about jubilees before.
Mm-hmm.
This is where everything grows up, right here in this delta. This is the nursery grounds for everything, for shrimp, fish, crabs. Everything we eat grows up right here.
It's all connected, this
system. It's all connected. That's your shrimp, your crabs, your fish, and everything.
Well,
so that's the reason we need to take care of this delta. Absolutely.
And this time of day, this time of year, I don't know of a prettier sight looking
up into the
delta.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And you know, when you get up in there, there's so much to see. Yeah. And every, like I say, every day is different. And, you know, that's my refuge.
Well,
I've been over here since I was a kid, you know. When I was 9 or 10 years old, they would come leave me up at Otto's Fish Camp, and I'd rent a rowboat for $1 a day, and I'd spend the whole day up in the Delta, and they'd come back and pick me up that afternoon.
Well, one reason we wanted to talk to you about language and dialect is that you've lived here all your
right,
life.
Right, yeah.
And the other reason is you have an experience with someone being interested in the way you talk. Tell right. us about that.
Well, yeah, when I guess you're speaking about Forrest Gump.
Yes.
I kind of hate to get into that, you know. They drove me crazy when the movie came out, because Jessica Drake, have you ever heard of her? She's a dialect coach. She was Tom Hanks' dialect coach. And she taped a bunch of conversations with me for him to study and to supposedly learn a Southern dialect. And, you know, when the movie came out, the way he talked, I hate to say it, but he sounded like an idiot. So I don't know whether I will claim that or not. But, you know, I don't care now. I don't care right. what they think. I'm this is the way I was born, and that's yeah. the way I talk. And I don't know, maybe it's not different, but it's so, a lot of people think it's different. I call people on the phone, and, you know, just being polite, I say, this is Jimbo Mutter, and they'll say, no joke.
Unmistakable. Well, I tell you what, you pronounce bluegill very well. So why don't we go grab a bite to eat at the bluegill?
Sounds good to me.
All right, well, let's head on out.
In contrast to our southeastern Alabama speakers, Jimbo does not use the flat I before voiceless consonants, demonstrating a difference from what we have heard thus far. Additionally, Jimbo's account of the Forrest Gump dialect coach is fascinating. When he heard Tom Hanks' dialect in the Forrest Gump film, it sounded idiotic to him. However, Jimbo is defiant in choosing to stand behind his dialect of identity and is not apologetic, but proud of its reflection of who he is and where he's from. A significant component of Jimbo's dialect, and hence identity, is the R-lessness traditionally associated with the Gulf Coast, a feature that we will continue to listen for as we meet Mary Cusar the following morning in Mobile's Bienville Square.
Mary, I appreciate you being a good sport, letting us come and you know, this particular episode is about the way people speak in Alabama, in Lower Alabama, in South Alabama. And we found that it's kind of awkward to ask people to talk about the way they talk. But we appreciate you being a good sport, so.
I'll do my best.
Okay.
One thing that I have been curious about is your impression of how people talk in Mobile.
Well, I think that having grown up here and spent all my life, with the exception of a year and a half away, I have thought throughout the years that we have sort of two distinct accents, if you will. We have a group of folks who have been here for a long time, who have roots here, that some go back to the beginning of our city in 1703. And we have people who have moved here, that came here from other spots in Alabama, who came here from other places in the South during World War II to work at Brookley. And I think they've all come together to have some distinct impact on the way we all talk. The folks who've been here for a long time and who have been the leaders in our city as well as our society, who have a rather distinct accent. They have a little more of a Southern drawl, something that you might relate to maybe Charleston or Savannah. And then we have everybody else. And I think that we have a beautiful language here. both of our accents are pretty, and they are soothing, and they are calm. And I feel like as we move along and Mobile grows and the South continues to grow, I hope that we don't lose that. We talk a little slower, and we have, I think, a gentleness about our accent. So in that respect, both of the accents in Mobile are, to me, a very nice Southern way of expressing ourselves and continuing our heritage, but also looking to the future to encourage other people to come here.
Seems like the language maybe fits the style of living in a way here
in Mobile.
It does.
It does. We move along, but we don't rush. Everything's not rush.
And I know, speaking of moving along, that you have a meeting.
I do.
And you fit us in before your meeting, and I appreciate it so much. And we just might walk with you towards your meeting.
Please do.
All righty. Thank you so much, though, Mary.
You're welcome.
Mary sees language differences that reflect the history of Mobile, but sees this diversity not as a negative, but a melding. She sees Mobile as a different Alabama because of its unique history. After our short walk with Mary, Anna and I took a few minutes to enjoy Bienville Square and assess what we've observed thus far in our look at speech in Alabama.
Anna, we've been from the Wiregrass to Mobile Bay, and we've talked to a variety of people, and we've learned a few things. What do you think about the sample in terms of, it's awfully small, the sample of speakers that we've talked to and what we can kind of get from that?
I think that what we've seen is that, or what our participants have shown us, is that language really is so much about identity and how people choose to represent themselves.
Well, I've enjoyed this two-day jaunt across Lower Alabama, and I really appreciate your time and the college letting us have you for a couple of days. And I'm really looking forward to our trip to North Alabama, and especially getting into a territory that we think will be more R-ful.
Absolutely, I'm looking forward to it too.